you all may have seen. The fact of the matter is, this is not our smallest service. I preached to two people one time in the very beginning. That was a little tough, but I did it. But I do want to thank everybody for coming out. And we're going to take our morning offering in just a few minutes. But you know, I want to share something with you before I did. As many of you know, my life is considerably different than what it was maybe 10 years ago or 15 years ago or 20 years ago. And just about a little over 20 years ago, I had a great opportunity through Toyota, who I was one of the sales managers at, to win a trip. And they took me to China and Hong Kong. It was really a wonderful vacation. And a good part about it was free. I could never afford to do that. But got to see parts of the world that I would never get to see. But the flight over there was about 22 hours long. So we get over and I'm exhausted, I'm tired, and they lose our luggage. So we're up about 30 hours before we get all that straight. But when we finally get it done, we give our luggage to somebody they call a steward. Now it was still our luggage, but somebody else was taking care of it. And before we got to our room, where we were just totally exhausted and asleep, the steward, who was taking good care of our stuff, had brought it to our room and laid everything out where it was easy to get to. Mm. Well, the Bible says that we're to be stewards. In Ephesians chapter 6, it says, indeed, if you heard the stewardship of the grace of God, which was given to me, to you, God has made us steward of everything, including our earth. And we forget that. Now, we're going to talk a little bit more about that in detail next year as we look over stewardship in many different ways. Because sometimes we think stewardship is just about money, but it's not. Everything that we have, God has given us, and we forget that sometimes. We're responsible to be good stewards of what He's given us. And that does include our finances as well. And God tells us that we don't tithe because He needs the money. In fact, He tells us everything belongs to me anyway. He says, the reason I ask you to tithe is because I want you to understand that you're to put me first. Now, if you tithe, it may mean you have to give up $4 lattes occasionally. It may mean that you can't go out to dinner as often. God wants you to know that He's more important than a latte. God wants you to understand that He's more important than a dinner. That He should come first. Now, here's the amazing thing to me. The more that I have given back to God, the more He's given to me. Now, I misunderstood Malachi 3:10 for many, many years. It said, if you give to me, test me in this matter, I will open the floodgates of heaven and bless you. Now, I gave with a wrong heart. I want you to know that. I'm going to be honest with you. I'm going to be transparent. I gave thinking if I gave God $10, He'd give me $100. And I can continue to give, and He continued to take things out of my life. I'm like, Lord, I don't understand this. I'm being obedient. Folks, I'm going to tell you something. I don't have the earthly wealth I used to have. But God opened the floodgates of heaven. I have more peace. I have more joy. I have more happiness. I have more of what matters than I've ever had in my life. Amen. God changed my heart from an obligated giver to a happy giver. And when He did, it changed my world. But it changed the world of the people around me too. My wife became more obedient in her giving. My children gained more obedient in their giving. And I just want to say this morning that I love my church. I love my church because you know what? The people in this room today, the people that come here, you are the church. And that means I love you. So I thank you and I'm going to pray for us. And then we'll get into this morning's message. Heavenly Father, I want to thank you, Lord, that even though it's raining outside, I've been so fortunate. I've been given this new series that we're going to study at the beginning of the year called A Transformed Mind. And one of the things I've learned is sometimes we have to create our own weather. It can be raining on the inside. It can be raining on the outside. But inside my heart, inside my body, I can have all the sunshine that I want if I just make up my mind and I transform my mind that I'm going to be that person that just basks in the rays of your sun. So I thank you for that. I thank you for what has been given to me and the tools that have been given to me through obedient servants of yours. Father, as we come today, we say a special prayer for those in the United States who've been affected by this storm, for the million of people in Florida who are without electricity, for those that have lost personal belongings, Lord, give them peace and let them understand that you are the sovereign God, and we may not understand what's going on, but you have everything under control, that you even have them in the very palm of your hands. And a special prayer to those in Haiti, Lord, who, Lord, they live in these villages at the bottom of mountains, and when it rains, the mudslides kill hundreds upon hundreds. I read one story in which in just one village alone, almost 300 people were killed in a single act. But I can't even begin to fathom that, the misery and the grief that must be going on there. But Father, somehow, some way, let them see you through the rain. Let them see you through the trials and the tribulation. And Father, let us give us praise today. Let us give praise to the God who watches over us and loves us. And Father, we thank you. Help us be good stewards of what you have given us, to multiply and use it for your will, to purchase and use this in a way that will glorify you through not only our own lives, not only the Odyssey Church, but have far-reaching arms around the world and into our community. Father, we thank you and praise you in the holy name of your Son, Jesus the Christ. Amen. Amen. Now, if you will, please watch this video as I get ready to bring this morning's message.
I love my church.
Think about how powerful it would be if everyone who came to church did at least one small thing to demonstrate God's love for others in ways of service, in maybe helping someone who is in need, or delivering a meal, or just welcoming people to church on a Sunday morning. How different it would be for people who come visit our churches. I think it would be so much more impactful that we are truly living what we preach, the model that Jesus gave us.
All right, and as I'm welcoming you this morning, I'm going to go back and turn off this music that's playing in the background, which I forgot to do. First of all, I do thank everybody for coming out this morning, and I thank everybody that's in here today has been here through this entire series. But if not, we're in part three of a five-part series called I Love My Church. And again, just to sort of catch you up, if you haven't been here, I'm going to give you the condensed version. If for some of you want to repeat the message, or you hear a message that you think is important for somebody you know to hear, you know, you can always find them on YouTube. You can always find them on our website. And I know there's still things God has to work around. I mean, sometimes it pride is one of them. First sin went through Satan out of heaven. But really, we are blessed to have our very own app, the Odyssey Church app. You can download it on your phones. And when I talk to big churches, they go like, "You have your own app?" I'm like, "Yeah, we got our own, of course, don't you?" But that's Satan working in me, and I know that, and I ask for forgiveness. But it is pretty cool to have your own app, and I haven't really advertised it a lot yet, because there's a lot of work that I want to do before I announce it publicly on Facebook and things like that. And I just haven't, it takes a lot of time to do that stuff, but I'm really fortunate. I have my mom and occasionally one of her friends that come in on Tuesdays and help me out, and they're doing a lot of filing that have been piling up for years. My office doesn't look great, but it looks better than it used to, and I thank her for that. And Trina's going to start coming in and doing some work on the computer, and that's going to start on Tuesday, and I'm so proud of her, and I'm so happy that she's willing to help me. And her words are the same words that I hear from all of you. I just want to serve God. And that's amazing to me, because I've been in a lot of big churches where people just come in on Sundays and then leave. And in most churches, you have this, what they call a 20-80 rule. 20% of the people do 80% of the work. And really, in churches, it's a 90-10 rule most of the time. But in this church, 90% of the people, or 10% of the people do 90% of the work. It's just, whatever I'm saying, 90% of the people here work in this church. And it's just amazing to me. But anyway, sort of to catch up, give you a real quick condensed version about what we talked about in the last 2 weeks. And in the first lesson, in the introduction lesson, We talk about how Jesus commands us to love one another like he loved her. He commands us to love people, but the amazing thing is, and because it goes against the world standards, we like to love people that love us. The more somebody loves on us, the more we love on them. But Jesus said, no, I want you to love your enemies. And in one verse, he says, if somebody slaps you on the left cheek, return and let them slap you on the right cheek. Or if they slap you on the right cheek, let them turn on and slap you on the left cheek. Now, most people are right-handed, and what most people don't realize in the back, the one of the biggest signs of disrespect in that time in history was a backhand slap. So you slap them on the right cheek. He said, turn around and give them the left cheek, which was a backhanded slap. He said, I want you to love people like I love people. First message, we talked about loving people like Jesus loved people, and Jesus thought people were to God. He was talking to his disciples. I mean, it was the last night before he had any freedom. It was just a couple of hours before he would be arrested and beaten and ridiculed and mobbed and stretched out on a cross. And sometimes we think about the death of the cross and how excruciating it is. And I didn't even know this, but the word excruciating actually comes from the Latin, and it means cross. The word in our English language, which comes from the Latin, to tell you how terrible a death was on the cross, the word excruciating actually means cross as the beginning of it. Now, dying on the cross just wasn't painful. We see Jesus standing up there with a towel around him, but that's not how it really is. That's just the way we've been pictured. They were stripped naked. They were humiliated. It wasn't just the pain. It was the humiliation as people walked by and saw you suffering and dying and standing there completely naked. In fact, it was such a horrible death that if you were a Roman citizen, it was against the law. No matter what a Roman citizen did, you couldn't put them on a cross. And as Jesus knew this was happening, he was talking to his disciples, which means he was talking to those of us who call ourselves Jesus followers. And he says, I'm giving you a new commandment. Now, to some of you, this may sound sacrilegious. I hope it does. It's not what I mean. But as Moses was about to take this journey through the desert, God says, I'm going to give you just simply 10 rules, Moses. You go take them down to the people and you follow them, and you will be showing me how much you love me and how much you trust me. Just 10, that's all you got to keep. And I envision God calling Jesus over one day and say, son, you know I love those people, but they are so stiff-necked, they're so hard-hearted, they can't even take 10 simple rules. Can you go down there and just give them 2? So one day a guy asked Jesus, said, what is the greatest commandment? He said, love God, and love others as you love yourself. Love God with all your heart, all your soul, all your mind, all your strength, and love others as yourself. Just 2 rules now. Just keep to do it. And even goes as far as says, everything that's written in Scripture, everything the prophet says, everything I say can do on these 2 things. So now it's the night before his death, and I imagine he's praying, and as he's praying, his dad looks down upon him and says, son, I love those people down there, but they're so stiff-necked they can't even keep 1-2 rules. Give them 1. Just give them 1. Maybe they can do that. Jesus says, I'm giving you a new commandment. Love each other just as I have loved you. You should love each other. Your love for one another will prove to the world that you are my disciple. He said, if you'll just love one another, you'll prove to the world that you're my follower, my disciple. You sit at the master's feet and learn from the master. And then the next day, with his arms outstretched, naked, beaten beyond recognition, Jesus showed us what he meant when he said, love one another as I have loved you. And we think about that and say, you know what, Lord, I don't think I can do that. I don't think I can love people like that. God looks down upon us and says, you know what? You can't in your own power. You have to make up your mind. You have to decide to make a great commitment to the great commandment. You have to make a great commitment to loving God with all your soul, with all your heart, with all your mind, You have to make a great commission, a great commitment to the Great Commission. And I don't know if you remember these words. These are the instructions that Jesus gave to his disciples. And most of you know this, and it sort of sounds weird if you're not a Christian. But as Jesus ascended back into heaven, his final instructions to his disciples before he ruled from heaven, says, make disciples of all the nations, teaching them to obey everything I commanded you. What did he command us to do? Commanded us to love each other. So if you make a great commitment to the great commandment and the great commission, you can't help but become a great church and make a great difference. Now, when I say church, I'm not talking about sticks and bricks. I'm talking about the church, which if you consider yourself a Jesus follower, you are the church. In other words, when you make a great commitment to the great commandment and the great commission, you will make a great difference, not only in your life, but also in the lives of the people around you. If we, all in here, just the 10 or 11 of us are in here this morning, if we would make a great commitment to the great commandment and the great commission, Odyssey Church itself would be known as a great church, because we will be known as the disciples of Jesus by how we love each other. And what I love about the Odyssey Church is that the people in here know it's not about the Odyssey Church. The people in here know that it's about loving God and loving people. It's not about sticks and bricks. It's not about a building. We are the church. We need to come into the church. We need to learn. We need to be fed. But it's not about the sticks and the bricks. It's about loving God and loving people. It's about something much bigger than the Odyssey Church. It's about loving people like Jesus loved people. It's about making a great commitment to the great commandment and the great commission so we, as a body of Christ, can make a big difference. In other words, it's not about sticks and bricks. It's about loving God and loving people. Because people who know they are loved much, love much. Amen. The more we love on people, the more we show them that they are loved, the more they'll love back. And if we'll just love people like Jesus loved people, we're going to make a big difference, not just in our own lives, but we'll make a big difference in the lives of the people we love and the lives of the people around us. And if we all do that, if we all will love people to such a degree that they know that they are loved, that they know we're not doing it out of a sense of obligation, that we're doing it because we truly love people, because we know they are God's people and we are loving them as we love ourselves, then we can't help but change the people around us. And if we change enough people around us, we'll change our community, because we will all have a like mindset. We will all be in one accord. We will all be in unity. And when we get in unity and we love people like Jesus loved people, then we can change our community. And the way we said we, to help you remember that, was Christian unity is good for our community. Christian unity is good for our community. Because people who know they are loved, love. People who know they are loved much, love much. And if you love people like Jesus loved people, and people know you love them, they're going to love you back. If they think you're doing it out of some kind of obligation, they will not. If they think you're doing it because you truly love them, they will love you back. And not only will we be changed, our community will be changed. That was sort of the point of last week's message, loving people through our community. And if we get in unity and love people like Jesus loved people, then we can change our community, because Christian unity is good for our community. So often in churches, we put fences up, don't we? And it's pretty amazing. It really happens in young Christians, and some of them never grow out of it. They remain childish. God calls us to be childlike, not childish. And they think it's about the rules and the regulations. I see that in a lot of new Christians. But unfortunately, a lot of them, the more they know, the more legalistic they become, and the more they grow in that. And then when they do, they're putting fences up. And those fences do one, two things. They either keep people inside that look like them and keep people outside that don't look like them. Keep people inside that act like them and keep people outside that don't like them. And so often it's true that you put these fences up, and they may not be a physical fence, but let me assure you, they are a fence. And the thing is, this isn't something new. It's addressed in both the Old Testament and the New Testament. Fences in churches, if you will, fences in the body of Christ, fences that keep people coming into the kingdom of God, keeping people away from God, been around for centuries, millennia. The prophet Isaiah addressed it in the Old Testament, 750 years before Jesus was born. And Jesus quotes the words of the prophet Isaiah. And he doesn't quote it to those who are non-believers. He's quoting these words to the religious people who were building fences. And this is what he says. You hypocrites. Isaiah was right when he prophesied about you. When he wrote, these people honor me with their lips. They come to church every week. They raise their hands. They know the scriptures. They sing the songs. They honor me with their lips, but their hearts are far from me. Their worship is a farce. It does no good. For they teach these man-made ideas as if they are commands from God. Folks, I want to tell you something, and I know that there are going to be people that would hear this message that wouldn't allow me to ever speak in their church. But when you condemn somebody for not following the rules, for having to read a certain translation of the Bible, folks, let me tell you something. King James is a translation. All right? You condemn people because they have to wear a certain type of clothes to church. If you condemn them because they got to sing a certain kind of songs, I heard a pastor say something one time like, that Kirk Franklin is going to go straight to hell. If you've ever heard Kirk Franklin's song, folks, I'm going to tell you, I can get up and dance to Kirk Franklin. And if you read his words, the words in his song are more scriptural than some of the songs that are in the pews, in the back of hymnals, in some of the churches.
Look at
Bishop. Look at Bishop. If you condemn somebody for breaking rules that you can't even keep yourself, you're building fences and you're keeping people from entering the kingdom of God. And God tells us in the book of Matthew, Jesus speaking, woe to those who keep people from entering the kingdom of God because you yourself are going to keep from entering the kingdom of God. Woe to you, you hypocrites, who keep people from entering into the kingdom of God and keep yourself out as well. It would be better for you to have a millstone tied around your neck and thrown into the water. Mm. Pretty strong words from Jesus. Anytime you condemn somebody for not following the rules, anytime you do any of these things, you are building a fence, and that fence keeps some people from entering into the kingdom of God. Now, how do you think God feels about that? Anytime you build a fence which stands outside of the truth of love, you're building a fence which keeps people from coming in, and keep people from loving people. And I know for a fact, because we've talked about it, some of you in this room have experienced that before. And I want you to know I'm sorry that that ever happened to you, but I also want you to know you're the very reason we started the Ozzy Church. We don't care what you've done. To be real honest with you, I don't even care what you're doing. Because I care more about where you're going. Does that mean we're not going to teach truth? Does that mean that we're not going to hold you accountable? Of course not. But I love you enough that I don't care where you are. We want to take you to where God wants you to be. And that's the very reason we started the Odyssey Church. That's what I love about this church, is that everybody is welcome at the Odyssey Church. That's just one of the many reasons that I love the Odyssey Church. And then we ended last week with this question. Are you building fences or are you tearing down fences? Because there is no in between. You've either built a fence and you're standing behind it, or you're building a fence to stand behind, or you're tearing down fences and letting people come into the kingdom of God and feel the love and warmth of Jesus Christ. Your actions, your words, are either building fences that's going to keep some people in and other people out, or you're loving people like Jesus loved people. by tearing down any fences that are going to keep one of God's children away from him and from entering into the kingdom of God. So there you have it. The last 2 weeks' message, done in about 10 minutes. But that's not how I roll, is it? So, we're in week 3 of our messages. I love my church, and today we're going to talk about service. And I have to tell you, sometimes God does amazing things in my life, and he throws me a curveball I'm not expecting, and this week was no different. I spent hours studying this message. Saturday afternoon, about 2 o'clock, I said, throw it all away. And he gave me a message that hopefully somebody in here needs to hear this morning. Loving people through service. And you know, I don't know about you, but a lot of times, again, I try to be transparent. I try to be honest. I'm just a normal human being. My speech doesn't change who I am or the fact that I'm human. When I think of Christian service sometimes, I don't have the most positive thoughts. I think about long hours and no pay. I think about things like I got to give up my time for somebody else's time. When I think of Christian service, not always the most pleasant thoughts pop up in my mind. I got to have work time and give up my play time. Somebody else's needs at the cost of my own needs. Do you know what? The Apostle Paul tells us this should not be so. In Galatians chapter 5, verse 13, he says this, "For you have been called to live in freedom." He says, you have the freedom to have playtime and not work time. You have that freedom. He said, but that's not what you're called to. He said, don't use your freedom to satisfy your sinful nature. Instead, use your freedom to serve one another out of obligation. Doesn't say that at all, does it? To serve one another in love. Yes, we have freedom in Jesus Christ. But that freedom wasn't given to us to serve ourselves. That liberty that God has given us wasn't given so we can go out and do anything that we want. That freedom has been given to us to love one another, to serve one another, to serve one another in love. Yes, we have freedom in Christ. I have a friend of mine, and him and his wife were the most legalistic people I ever met. I loved them dearly. They loved me dearly at one time. And they were about the most, for lack of a better word, righteous family I knew. She would never wear pants, always wore dresses. Didn't believe she should ever cut her hair, wore it up in a bun. They grew their own food on her farm. They had hymn sings with their children every Saturday morning. They read only the King James Bible. They lived this life that looked so righteous. Their kids grew up. They got older. And as kids left the house, they started to fight more often. One day, in the middle of an argument, she reaches out and bites his nose. And I guess she bit him pretty hard because he called the police. Last time I talked to the man, and I still see him occasionally, he was visiting prostitutes, he was drinking in bars, he was smoking cigars, he was doing everyone. He said, I have freedom in Christ. I got tired of being in, tired of being out. I have this freedom in Christ. I can do anything I want because I'm saved, and God's forgiven. Mm. And yet God's word, and he tried to explain it to somebody, and God's word says, you'll be known as my disciple if you obey my commands. And I said, you're not obeying his commands. His wife went the other direction. She left Christianity altogether and became a Jehovah's Witness. Because they were serving out of obligation, not out of love. They felt they had to keep these rules, and they couldn't keep the rules. And as her kids went away, and it was just the two of them, they knew they couldn't keep the rules, and it started to cause arguments between them. For you have been called to live in freedom, my brothers and sisters, but do not use your freedom to satisfy your sinful nature. Use your freedom to serve one another in love. See, as long as they were serving their family, because they loved their family, they were fine. But when their family left and they didn't serve anybody else in love, legalism set in. You know, to love people like Jesus loved people, one of the most loving things you can do is to serve them, right? I mean, you know, sometimes in a marriage you go through these rough patches. And me and my wife went through a rough patch one time, and because of that, we stopped serving each other. We sort of drifted apart, and things got heated. And I'm not saying she didn't do anything different. I'm not saying, you know, we were both wrong. But one day I came to the conclusion, you know, we've been married for 15 years, and she ain't changed. All I'm doing is get upset. After 15 years, this thing that she's doing, she's probably not going to change. So I have a choice to make. I can stay miserable and mad all the time about something that's not going to change, or I can just be happy and repent, change my way of thinking and change my actions. And you know what happened when I did that and I started serving her again? She started serving me again. And in love, we served each other. When it was obligation, when it was law, we were ready to get divorced. I hate to say it. But when we started in love serving one another, it's a beautiful thing, and we're going to be married 21 years in about 2 days. So we have this freedom, but I want you to think about it this way. We have this freedom, and a way to think about it is, I will invest in you at the expense of me because I love you as I love me. I love you like I love myself, and because I love you like I love myself, I will invest in you at the expense of me because I love you like I love me. That is a great commitment to the Great Commission. Now, somebody who knew what it meant to make a great commitment to the Great Commission was a man by the name of William Borden. Now, that name may not mean anything to you. He was called, and he knew he was called, to serve one another in love. Now, maybe some of you have heard this. I don't know if you've ever heard of Borden Dairy Milk or Borden Ice Cream. Mm-hmm. Okay, it's not readily available around here. It's mostly in the South, like Piggly Wiggly's, or some of the places down there. Piggly Wiggly, Winn-Dixie, Pick and Save. National chains like Kmart, Rite Aid, they picked it up.
It's in Baltimore.
Walgreens, some of the bigger chains have picked it up as well. They carry it. But back in 1904, the heir to this Borden's Dairy Estate, one of his relatives, a man by the name of Galen, I think, Galen Borden, actually is considered the man who is the father of the modern dairy process. So at the time, they controlled most of the market in the United States for milk and ice cream and dairy products. He was a millionaire when he graduated from a Chicago high school. Now, being a millionaire at 18 is a pretty cool thing, right? For his graduation present, his parents gave him a trip around the world. Now, we could go around the world in 7 days today with airplanes, but back then it was getting on a ship and spending months, if not a year away. And it was very, very expensive, even by comparison in today's world, extremely expensive. Being a millionaire at 18 has some benefits, doesn't it? But now, as William Borden is traveling around the world, he starts to develop this great burden. See, William Borden's parents had raised him in a Christian faith. And although they weren't as active in their church as some might think, they still had great Christian values, and William Borden accepted Christ at an early age. And as he's traveling around the world, as he gets to Europe and Asia and some of the other countries, particularly in the areas where there was a Muslim influence, he begins to have this great burden for the people that he saw that were having so much suffering. So he makes a decision. He makes a decision that he's going to start preparing for the mission field. Now, he's only 18 years old. He's seen this, and his heart's broken over what he's seen. And he starts preparing for the mission field. It's almost as if he's had an epiphany. It's almost as if his whole, he has realized something and nothing is ever going to be the same again. That his earthly life of wealth and luxury is about to be over, and his life as a missionary is about to begin. His work, his life is going to start going in a different direction. And when he made that decision, he wrote two words in the back of his Bible. He gets a pen out and he writes, "No reserve. I've made my decision. I'm going to pour it all out. There will be no reserve." Now, he does stay in the United States to go to school, and he goes to Yale. In the first year at Yale, as he's studying in seminary as a freshman, his passion for Christ is burning, and it's been ignited, and it's deeper than it's ever been. But when he gets there, he's so disappointed. He looks out at this school, and he sees that it's morally bankrupt, that the teaching is filled with empty philosophy. And as I'm reading this story, I'm thinking, what in the world would he think about it today? If he thought it was full of empty philosophy, and it was full of worldly things, and it was morally bankrupt in 1905 or 1906, what would he think of it in the year 2016? So during this first semester, he asked a friend, he said, "Listen, will you meet me every morning for breakfast, and let's pray together?" William Borden, he's a natural leader. So as he begins praying, others begin praying with him. And then all of a sudden, prayer groups start popping up all over the campus. At this point in history, there's only 1,300 students at Yale University. And of the 1,300 students, by the time he graduates, 1,000 of them are in prayer groups. And a lot of the world's leaders at that time who graduated from Yale contribute their Christian faith to William Borden in the prayer groups that he started. So William Borden is this natural born leader. William Borden, who's this millionaire, the heir to the Borden Dairy Estate. So once he graduates, naturally, this born leader who has political and worldly influence through his family's business, through his associates, through the friends, the kind of people you hang around with when you're millionaires and at Yale and those kind of things, he's offered tremendous jobs with great pay, great influence. I mean, here's a man who really has everything the world has to offer. He's already got wealth. If you see a picture of him, and I meant to put one up and didn't, I should have, he was a good-looking man too. So you got this man who has worldly wealth. You have this man who's a good-looking guy. This man who's a born leader. He's already got fortune and fame is knocking at his door. But this man turns down all of that. He turns out everything. He turns those jobs down and everything that goes with them and continue to pursue God's call in his life. Now as he's writing this down, he's contemplating all this, he goes back to his Bible. He's wrote down "no reserve." Now he writes down two more words. He writes down the words "no retreat." No reserve, no retreat. So when he finishes at Princeton, he sails to China to work with the Muslims that his heart's been so broken over. He's going to serve others in love. Now, in order to help him serve more aptly, he stops over in Egypt to learn Aramaic. Now, while he's in Egypt, he's 25 years old. While he's in Egypt, he comes down with spinal meningitis. And within a month, as his friends and his family are going through his belongings after his death and after his funeral, they come across his Bible, and what they find in there brings them great comfort. First he wrote the words, "no reserve." Then he wrote the words, "no retreat." And knowing that his young life was about to end, he writes these other two words, "no reserve, no retreat, no regret." Here's a man who's born a millionaire. And yet he lays down his robes of this world. He picks up the towels of service. And he says, "No reason, no retreat, no regret." A man that could have lived his entire life and lived a long life in luxury with worldly possession, worldly position, and worldly power, yet he pours himself out to the point that there was nothing left. There was no reserve. William Borden gave everything he had, all his worldly wealth, all the luxury which came with that, his house, his health, and now his very own life. And he writes, no reserve. He went forward. He went and pressed on. No matter how difficult the obstacles were, no matter what came up against him, he never looked back. He always pressed on. And he said, no retreat. I'm not turning back. I'm going forward. And even at the time of his death, he's only 25 years old, he says, no regret. No regret. No reserve. No retreat. No regret. Galatians 5.13, that is living out Galatians 5.13. For you have been called to live in freedom, my brothers and sisters. But don't use your freedom to satisfy your sinful nature. Use your liberty, use your freedom to serve one another in love. And I think about this. Wouldn't it be a wonderful thing? Wouldn't it be a great thing if each of us in this room today, just the ones that are in here this morning, if we would be reminded that we've been called to live in freedom by our Lord Jesus Christ, not to satisfy our sinful nature, but to use this freedom in Jesus Christ to serve one another in love. Wouldn't it be a magnificent thing if all of us would make up our minds to purposely and intentionally, by taking down, laying down our robes of this world, putting on the heavenly towel of service just to serve one another in love. Can you imagine? Can you look into your mind's eye? Can you imagine what it would do to your life? What it would do to the life of your friends? What it would do to the life of the people that you came into contact with? What it would do to our community if we would just serve one another? Not out of obligation, not because God told us to, but serve them in love. Love them like Jesus loved them. Serve them like Jesus served them. Can you imagine what our families would become? What our community would become? Wouldn't it be an incredible thing if we all left church this morning and became the church in the world by taking off our robes of this world and putting on our towel of service? Picking up the towel of heaven with those words of William Borden burned within our soul, written on our hearts. No reserve, no retreat, no regret. We come to the Gospel of John, and we have the story of Jesus washing the disciples' feet at the Passover meal, or what we know as the Last Supper. And it's just hours before Jesus is going to be arrested. Jesus has been ministering to the world. He's been ministering to his disciples, but now his ministry is going to go into a different direction. His earthly ministry is almost over. His heavenly ministry is about to begin. His work's now going to be different. The preparation was over. The reality is setting in. And if you have your Bibles this morning, turn into the Gospel of John, chapter 13, or your cellular devices. And if you don't have a Bible, that's cool. We got them over here. They're free. You take them with them. I normally speak out of the New Living Translation, and that's what they are over there. Again, that's what I'll be speaking out of this morning. And that's the Gospel of John, chapter 13. We're going to begin in verse 1. I'm only going to read a couple of verses to save time, because you know how I am. But you know, I want you to know something. And it's okay to write in your Bible. It's okay to highlight in your Bible. It's okay to actually write in them. I think God looks down with a special smile. Because we were talking about stewardship earlier. Be a good steward of what God lays on your heart. Write it down. Take notes. That's why if you look at the back of your bulletins, there's a place to take notes. Just don't assume that you'll remember what God has said to your heart to say this morning. You can forget everything I said. But please don't forget what God says. Be a good steward of it. Write it down. That's the Gospel of John, chapter 13. We're going to begin in verse 1. And again, I tell people, my eyes aren't what they used to be, so I assure you I have done the study, but hard for me to read the little words in the Bible anymore. And if I get one of them big ones, then I got to carry it like this. I got 2 more months before I'm supposed to use this arm, so we're good. So it starts out like this. Before the Passover celebration, Jesus knew that his hour had come to leave this world and return to his Father. He loved his disciples during his ministry on earth, and now he loved them to the very end. It was time for the supper, and the devil had already prompted Judas, son of Simon Iscariot, to betray Jesus. Now, even if you don't know a lot about the Bible, even if you haven't been to church a lot, you probably have heard the story of Judas betraying Jesus, and that is already in motion. That's already begun. Verse 3 goes on, Jesus knew. Now, I want to let you know up front again, transparency. I don't study Greek, but I do study people who do study Greek. It's easier that way, to be honest with you. I don't study Greek, but I study people who do study Greek. And what I've learned is the way that John writes this is written in such a way that Jesus has this epiphany, this eye-opener, as he looks around and he looks at his disciples sitting around at him. He has this epiphany, he has this eye-opening moment where he realizes something, or something that he already knew has been brought back to the surface. Jesus looks around, he looks at his disciples, and maybe it's dawned on him. I mean, I don't want you to think that Jesus didn't know what's about to happen. Jesus didn't learn anything new, but maybe something he already knew, he was knowing in a new way, or had been brought back to the surface, that he knew all of a sudden that his Father had put all things under his power, that his Father, that God had put all things under his authority. Jesus knew that the Father had given him authority over everything, and that he had come from God, and that he would return. So like I said, I don't think Jesus didn't know what was about to happen. I don't think he learned something new. But in this moment, something happened during this meal. As Jesus looked around and looked at his disciples, Jesus knew that the Father had given him authority over everything, and that he had come from God and would return to God. Jesus would pour himself out. He would give even his very life for the world, for the people he loved. He poured all he had out. There would be no reserve. See, for 3.5 years, Jesus had been preparing the disciples for this very moment. His eyes were fixed on the cross. What's amazing is Hebrews tells us he went joyfully to the cross. See, he would pour himself out. His eyes are now fixed directly on the cross. There was no reserve, and now there was no retreat. And just so that we would know that there were no regrets, the Master becomes the servant. Jesus takes off his robes of this world. He takes off his rabbinic robes, and he puts on the towel of a servant. Picks up the towel of heaven. So he got up from the table. He took off his robe, wrapped the towel around his waist, and poured it in a water basin. Then he began to wash his disciples' feet, drying them with the towel he had around him. See, the next day, Jesus would be hanging from a cross until he was dead. Don't let anybody ever tell you that Jesus wasn't dead when he was laid in a tomb. He was dead. Roman soldiers knew what death was. They specialized in death. They knew he was dead. If by some chance they made a mistake, they wrapped him in 80 pounds of cloth filled with anointing oil, he was suffocating. Jesus was dead. He had poured out his entire life. He gave it all. No reserve. No retreat. For your eternal soul. For my eternal soul. The perfect sacrifice for the forgiveness of sin. No reserve, no retreat, no regret. Here's what I hope you get. Here's the epiphany I hope you get this morning. It is time for us, time for those of us who call ourselves Christians, time for us who call ourselves Jesus followers, time for us who say we are disciples of the Lord Jesus Christ, to lay down our robes of this world and put on the towel of heaven. And I don't know what your robe is. It's different for all of us. You know, maybe for some of you it is a figurative robe of this world. Maybe for one or two of you, it's a literal robe. You have let your wealth get you all bound up, and you've forgotten who provided your wealth in the first place. But maybe for some of you, I mean, this has been a problem all my life. It's the robe of work. How can the company ever get along without me? Without me? I don't even think they could survive. It's the robe of work in my life. I'm a perfectionist. I work hard. I like to see things. And sometimes God has to remind me, even if he has to break my arm, that you need to slow down. You have to take off the robe of this world. Put on the towel of heaven. And serve others. Maybe it's the robe of your family. Will my kids be okay? Will my wife even know I'm gone if I should decide to leave? Maybe for some of you, it's the robe of trials and tribulation. Maybe it's your health. Maybe it's your marriage. Maybe it's your finances. Maybe it's something else, I don't know. The robe is different for all of us, but it's time to lay down our robes of this world and put on the towel of heaven, to put on the servant's towel. Somebody once put it this way, and for those of you who have been coming for a while, I know I've used this illustration before. I'm not getting that senile yet. Probably on its way, but it hadn't happened yet. It's that we take off our bibs and we put on our apron. Now, bib is not a word that we use a lot here in the United States. The English writer wrote that. This is a bib. This is a bib. You know what a bib is for? Bib is for people. Bib is for people who are infants. A baby is for children. A baby is for eating and being fed, not for serving. Take off your bib and put on your apron. An apron is a sign of maturity. You don't give an apron to a baby. You give an apron to a servant. Bibs are for infants. Aprons are for servants. For you have been called to live in freedom, my brothers and sisters. But don't use that freedom to satisfy your sinful nature. Instead, use that freedom to serve one another in love. No reserve, no retreat, no regret. In other words, let us become servants to not only those we love, but those around us that are maybe difficult to love, to those that we don't even know, to those that look different than we do, to those who talk different than we do, to those who act different than we do, to those who maybe we don't even like what they do and we know they're going against God, but let's serve them in love. Let's take off our bibs and put on our aprons. Let's love people like Jesus loved people, like Jesus showed us and commanded us to do by his word and example, to serve one another in love. I mean, he even reminds us, for even the Son of Man came not to be served, but to serve others and to give his life as a ransom for many. No reserve, no retreat, no regrets. Maybe some of you are sitting there thinking like I was when I was studying that. Sure, Jesus can do that. Jesus is God in a bod. Jesus can do that. Doesn't the Bible say that God sent this Holy Spirit to help Jesus withstand the temptation of Satan when he was in the desert at the beginning of his ministry? Doesn't the Bible say that God sent angel to him in the Garden of Gethsemane to help him out and stand the pain of what he was about to go through at the end of his ministry? Sure, Jesus can do that. Jesus can say, no reserve, no retreat, no regret. But I can't do that. Here's what I want you to know this morning. You may have forgotten. Maybe you don't pay attention to it. Maybe you don't even believe it. The Bible says God has given you everything. Everything that he gave his Son. See, the Bible also says the Spirit of God who raised Jesus Christ from the dead lives in you. Mm-hmm. And just as God raised Jesus Christ from the dead, he will give power to your mortal bodies by this same Spirit living within you. You have God's power. You have God's presence living in you. You say, well, Jesus could do that. He was God. He had God's power. He had God's presence. He's had God angels. You have God's presence and power living in you. Yeah, but Jesus still had angels to help him out. I don't have no angels. Let me remind you of the words of Psalm 91. If you make the Lord your refuge, if you make the Most High your shelter, no evil will conquer you. No plague will come near your house. For he will order his angels to protect you wherever you go. They will hold you up with their hands and you won't even hurt your foot. Honest, don't they? See, if you make the Lord your refuge, if you make the Most High your shelter, he gives you his Spirit. The same Spirit. God gives you the same Spirit he gave his one and only Son. It ain't a different Spirit. You don't have one Spirit for Jesus and one Spirit for you. It is the same Spirit God gave his Son, the same Spirit which raised Jesus Christ from the dead is living in you.
Hallelujah.
Not a different Spirit, but the same Spirit. You got angels. You got the presence of God. You got the power of God. God has given you everything. He gave his Son so you can live a life where you and I can love people like Jesus loved people and serve people like Jesus served people in love.
That's real.
Amen. So let me tell you, there is a community of people all around us who need these fences that churches have put up torn down. They need to see Jesus. And you know what? You and I may be the only Jesus they ever get to see. Let's pour ourselves out for them. Let's pour ourselves out for the Lord Jesus Christ so at the end of our lives, we can say no reserve. I left it all on the table. There was nothing left. We need to advance the kingdom of God by loving people like Jesus loved people, by serving people like Jesus served people, by serving one another in love. We need to run to the cross. We need to run to serve one another in love, never looking back, always pressing on, always pushing forward. When things get tough, and they will get tough, we need to keep on. We need to keep serving one another in love. No retreat. And if you do this, at the end of your life, you'll look back on your life and you'll see what God has done in you and has done through you, and you will be able to say, no regret. See, I believe everybody in this room is here this morning by the sovereign will of God and the obedience of man. Or woman. See, there's some people that are supposed to be here this morning, but they didn't come because of the rain stopped. We have the sovereign will of God, but we have free will. And maybe there's somebody here today who needs to hear this message. No reserve, no retreat, no regret. You say, well, Jesus could do all those things, but he was God. I'm just a regular old human being. I can't do these things. I'm only human. Well, what about the Apostle Paul? He's just an ordinary person like me and you. We sometimes put him up on a pedestal. But he was just a man. He was just a human being. He was just like me and you. A man with a transformed mind. A man who had made up his mind. A man who was purposeful. A man who was intentional. But he was just a man. He was just a human like me and you. A person with a special calling upon his life. But guess what? Just like me and you, we have a special calling upon our lives. A man who changed the world by spreading the good news of Jesus Christ by the power of the Holy Spirit. Remember Jesus' last words before sending back into heaven? What the church calls the Great Commission? Go and make disciples of all the nation and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you? See, if we remember, it's not about bricks and sticks. If we'll remember, it's about Jesus and the body of Christ. If we'll remember that it's about loving God and loving people, we'll remember that it's about making a great commitment to the Great Commandment and the Great Commission so that we can make a great difference. By the God living in us, we can do amazing things as well.
That's right.
We got to remember it's about Jesus and the body of Christ. I love my church because the people in here, the people who come to the Odyssey Church, the people who make the Odyssey Church who it is, know it's not about the Odyssey Church. It's about loving God and loving people like Jesus loved God and loved people, and by serving people like Jesus served people. I love my church, which means I love everybody in here because you are the church. By making a great commitment to the great commandment and the great commission, with, you know, make a great commandment, loving God with all your heart and all your soul and all your mind and all your heart and strength. Make a great commitment to the great commission. Make disciples of the nations and teaching them to obey everything I have. When you make a great commitment to the great commandment and the great commission, you will make a great difference, not just in your life, but the lives of the people around you, the people that you love the most. And if we change enough lives, we'll change our community. And we may not change the world, but who knows? Somebody in here, some of you people are very young. Maybe you will change the world. But this much I'll promise you, if you make a great commitment to the great commandment and the great commission, if you'll love people like Jesus loved people, if you will serve one another in love, you may not change the entire world, but you'll change your world and the world around from the people around you. The apostle, ordinary person, like me and you, ordinary person who did extraordinary things by the power of an extraordinary God, living in Him, just like you and me, who can do extraordinary things by the power of an extraordinary God who's living in us. Apostle Paul, who at the end of his life, like Jesus at the end of his life, could say no reserve, no retreat, no regret, because he laid down the robes of this world and put on the cowl of heaven. He took off his bib and put on an apron. I mean, could this be what the Apostle Paul meant when he wrote to the Christians in Corinth? Could this be what the Apostle Paul meant when he wrote in 1 Corinthians chapter 11, imitate me as I have imitated Christ? Did Paul have any reserve at the end of his life? Do you think Paul ever retreated? Do you think Paul ever had any regrets? Do you think Paul, as he's walking towards his execution, changed to a Roman soldier, said, I wish I hadn't laid it all down? I wish that I had turned back at least once. I really regret that decision. That ain't what Paul was thinking. He was thinking no reserve, no retreat, no regrets. He had trials and tribulations that most of us could not even begin to comprehend. But he's never turned back. No matter what the obstacle was, Paul went forward, he pressed on, there was no retreat. At the end of his life, as a sword came down to chop off his head for preaching the good news of the gospel, I assure you, you had no regrets. In fact, if you don't believe me, you don't have to take my word. Take Paul's own words for it. He writes to Philippians and he says, but I will rejoice even if I lose my life, pouring it out like a liquid offering, pouring it out like a drink offering to God, just for the faithful service as an offering to God. I want all of you to share that joy. He said, even if I lose my life, I'm going to count it as joy. Paul said, I made up my mind. I am going to press forward. I am going to leave it all. There will be no reserve. There will be nothing left of me when I'm done serving Jesus. I'll be nothing to me when I get done serving His people. I will pour it out completely. Question is this morning, have you made up your mind to leave no reserve this morning? Have you decided to serve God and serve His people? Have you decided to lay down your robes of this world and put on the towel of heaven? Will you take off your bib and put on your apron? Will you make up your mind? No reserve. Paul says, I once thought all these other things were valuable, but now I consider them worthless. Because of what Jesus Christ has done. Yes, everything else is worthless when compared to the infinite value of knowing Jesus Christ as my Lord. For His sake, I have discarded everything else, counting it all as garbage, so that I could gain Christ and become one with Him. Paul said, I had it all. I had power, and I had position, and I had possessions. But now I count all that stuff as garbage because of what Christ has done for me. He says, I gained Jesus Christ and I became one with Him. And everything else this world has to offer me is nothing but garbage in comparison to being one with Jesus Christ. In another letter, in the letter to the 2 Corinthians, or his second letter to Corinthians, Paul tells us exactly what it cost him to serve God and to loved people as he loved himself. And Paul says, I know this sounds crazy. I know this goes against everything the world teaches you. I know this sounds crazy to you. So he starts out like this. He goes, I know I sound like a madman, but I have served him far more. I have worked harder. I have been put in prison more often. I have been whipped times without number. I have faced death again and again. 5 different times the Jewish leaders gave me 39 lashes. 3 times I was beaten with rods. Once I was even stoned. 3 times I was shipwrecked. Once I spent the whole night and a day adrift at sea. I have traveled on many long journeys. I have faced dangers in the rivers and danger from robbers. I have faced danger from my own people, the Jews, as well as the Gentiles. I have faced dangers in the cities and in the deserts and on the seas. I love this verse. I face danger from men who claim to be believers, but are not. I have worked hard and long and during many sleepless nights. I have been hungry and thirsty and have often gone without food. I have shivered in the cold without enough clothing to keep me warm. And then besides all this, I have the daily burden of my concern for all the churches. Who is weak without me feeling that weakness? Who is led astray and I do not burn with anger? Does it sound like Paul ever retreated? I mean, can we look in the mirror and say we never retreated? Look at the number of people who stayed home today just because it was raining. Do we retreat if we're tired? Do we retreat if there's something better to do? Do we retreat if there's a good ball game on TV? What would your friends and family say if they were asked how you walk with Jesus? What would they say? Make up your mind. Not sometime in the future, but today. Make up your mind that there will be no reserve, that there will be no retreat. Listen to the words of the Apostle Paul at the time of death. He knows he's about to die. These are the words written from the last letter we know Paul ever wrote. These are the words to Timothy, what we call 2 Timothy. And towards the end of that letter, chapter 4, he says, as for me, my life has already been poured out as an offering to God. The time of my death is near. I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race. I have remained faithful. And now the prize awaits me, the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will give me on the day of his return. Here's the good news of the gospel. Because you know it ain't good news unless, right? It ain't the gospel unless it's good news. And the prize is not just for me, but for all who eagerly look forward to his appearing. Does that sound like a man any regrets? The time of my death is near. I have no reserve. I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race. I have remained faithful. I never retreated. And now my prize awaits me. No regrets. No reserve. No retreats. No regrets. Now is the time to show our families. Now is the time to show our friends. Now is the time to show our communities. And yes, now is the time to even show our churches how to serve God and serve people like Jesus. Serve God and serve people with love. Jesus said in the Gospel of John chapter 13, I set before you an example that you should do as I have done for you. I tell you the truth. No servant is greater than the master, nor is a messenger greater than the one who sent him. Now that you know these things, you will be blessed if you do them. See, the good news is, that now that you know these things, and if you're in here this morning, you have no excuse because you now know these things. You will be blessed if you do them. There is a condition to the blessing. You have to do these things to get the blessings. You don't get the blessing until you become the blesser. It's time to be blessed. It's time to be a blessing. There's people all around us who are very, very far away from God who need to see Jesus in us so they can come known to know the living God who gives them hope and joy and peace. But you have to make up your mind to do it. Have you, like William Borden? Have you, like Jesus? Have you, like the Apostle Paul? Have you decided to lay aside the robes of this world and put on the towel of heaven and to serve one another in love? To take off your bib and to put on your apron? And serve God and serve his people, not out of a sense of obligation, but out of a sense of love. For you have been called to live in freedom, my brothers and sisters. But don't use your freedom to satisfy the sinful nature. Instead, use your freedom to serve one another in love. Here's the fact. Saved people serve people. saved people serve people? Have you realized that it's not about a church? That it's not about sticks and bricks, but it's about Jesus Christ, who is the head of the body of Christ? Have you made up your mind to let the world know that you will be a disciple of Jesus Christ by the way you love one another? Have you made up your mind to make a great commitment to the great commandment so you can make a great difference? Have you decided to lay aside whatever robe it is of this world that has held you back? Have you decided to put on your towel of heaven, the towel of service, to do as the book of Hebrews chapter 13 tells us to do? Strip off every weight that slows you down, especially the sins that so easily trips you up, and run with endurance the race that God has set before you. Do this by keeping your eyes on Jesus, the champion who initiates and perfects our faith. Take off every robe. Set aside everything that slows you down. Run with endurance. Surrender it all. Don't leave nothing on the table. No reserve. Have you, like William Borden, like Jesus, like the Apostle Paul, have you decided to lay aside the robes of this world and put on the towels of heaven and serve one another in love? Take off your bibs and put on your aprons? Have you made up your mind, as Paul did, to press on, to possess that perfection which Jesus Christ first possessed me? To focus on this one thing, to forget the past and look forward to what lies ahead? To press on, to reach the end of the race and receive the heavenly prize for which God, through Jesus Christ, has called you to do, to hold on to the progress you have already made? In other words, have you made up your mind? No retreat. Press on. Go forward. No turning back. No retreat. Have you, like William Borden, like Jesus, like the Apostle Paul, have you decided to lay aside the robes of this world and put on the towel of heaven, to put on a servant's towel and serve one another in love? Have you made up your mind to keep clear mind in every situation, to not be afraid of suffering for the Lord, to work at telling others the good news and fully carry out the ministry of God that He has set before you? So I'm going to promise you something. If you're the member of the body, if you're a member of the body, you have a ministry. You may not know what that ministry is yet, but if you're a member, you have a ministry. God works in you to work through you. So at the end of your life, you can say like the Apostle Paul said at the end of his life, I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race. I have remained faithful, and now the prize awaits me, a crown of righteousness. No reserve. No retreat. No regret. In the book, Seven Habits by Highly Successful People, Seven Habits of Highly Successful People by Stephen Covey, he said, begin with the end in mind. He gives this example. So imagine yourself walking into a funeral home. You smell the aroma of the flowers, the lilies. The lights are dimmed down. Music is playing softly. People are sobbing and they're crying. As your turn walks up to the casket, you look in the casket. You're the one laying in the casket. As you're listening to the people talk about you, what do you want them to say? What will the people say at the end of your life? Well, you know what? They really seemed like a nice person. You know what? They were a pretty good friend of mine. And they were such a wise business person. They were even sort of religious. They went to church most Sundays. Would they say, you know, I may not believe like that person believed, but I am so glad God put them in my life because they surrendered all. Would they be able to say that they gave their life, they lived for the one who died for them, they left nothing on the table, it was all poured out like a drink offering to God. They pressed on no matter what the obstacles, there was no reserve at the end of the life. Will they admire what you gained for yourself? Will they admire the power you acquired? Will they admire the position in life you rode to, the possessions you accumulated? Or they say they gave up their power for God's power. They lost their position to sit at the feet of the one in the most high position. They chose to give away their earthly possessions with moths and rust and thieves could destroy and be gone one day anyway for heavenly possessions that are stored up in heaven that will last for all eternity. I remember when they thought all those things were valuable, but after meeting Jesus Christ, the living God, they considered them to be worthless because of what Christ had done for them and in them and through them. Yes, everything they had became worthless when they compared the infinite value of knowing Jesus Christ as Lord. They discarded everything else, counting all as garbage, so they could gain Christ and be one with Him. They left no reserve. Once they made up their mind, there was no retreat. They never turned back. At the end of their life, there was not one regret. Folks, I'm going to tell you this morning, don't wait until it's too late to make that decision. Decide right now, right here, to make up your mind, to lay aside the robes of this world, whatever they may be to you, and put on the towel of heaven, take off your bib, and to put on your apron. To love people like Jesus loved people, to serve people like Jesus served people, to make a great commitment to the great commandment and the great commission so you can make a great difference in your life and the lives of the people you love. You know what? We can talk about this all day long. We can talk about it next week and the week after that. We can talk about it from now until Jesus Christ comes back. Until you make up your mind to do something, ain't nothing going to happen. We need to make up our minds. We need to be intentional and purposeful to stop serving our sinful nature and take this freedom we have in Jesus Christ to serve one another in love. Because Jesus works in you to work through you. But you have to make up your mind to love people like Jesus loved people and Jesus thought people were to die for. To serve people like Jesus served people in love or nothing will happen and nothing will change. And who knows? If you, if I, if we together make a difference in enough lives, we might just change the world. But I do know this. We may not change the entire world, but we'll change our world and we'll change the world of the people around us if we serve one another in love. And if we do this, if we love people like Jesus loved people, if we serve one another in love, we can be like William Gordon. We can be like the Apostle Paul. We can be ordinary people who do extraordinary things through the power of an extraordinary God living in us. So I challenge you this morning to make up your mind to build a stronger church by loving through community, by loving in service, by loving in giving, by loving in sharing. I challenge you this morning to live your life in such a way, to live your life by serving others in love. To live your life in such a way at the end of your life, you can say, no reserve, no retreat, no regret. I love my church, which means I love you, because you are the church. Amen. God bless you. Heavenly Father, we thank you and we praise you today for your loving glory. Father, we thank you that you just didn't give us words, but you gave us examples to live by. And Father, in our humanness, we know we're going to fall short. But Lord, when we do, we just come to you, confess, and you pick us up out of that miry clay, you dust us off, and you wipe us down, and you make us clean again. But Father, put a burden, as you put a burden upon William Gordon's heart, to love people like Jesus loved people, to serve one another in love. And Father, we don't have to travel to Egypt. We don't have to travel to China. We don't have to travel around the world. Father, there are people right here in Shelbyville that are addicted to drugs and they don't know a way out. There's people here living in poverty and they have no hope. There's people in our community, Lord, that have lost their will to live, Father. Help us to serve them. Give us extraordinary power through an extraordinary God to live extraordinary lives so that we serve one another in love so that others can see that we are your disciples, that we'll make this great commitment to the Great Commission and the Great Commission. I see their love for you, and I know that they have love for others. But Father, give us a willingness. Give us an intentionality. Give us a strategic plan to reach those that are far away from you and bring them into your kingdom of God, to tear down any fence we may have that would keep them out, and to serve and to love them as you served and loved us. And we ask this in the precious name of our Heavenly Father. Amen. Amen. Corinthians 4:20 says, for the kingdom of God is not just a lot of talk. It is living by God's power. So may the blessing of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit be among you and within you wherever you find yourself this week. And go out and live.